Welcome to the podcast, Whether or Not and to What Degree with Fox Carolina. I'm Chief Meteorologist Kendra Kent, alongside meteorologist Ben Dorenbach and meteorologist Isaac Williams. This is where we get to talk weather, and we don't have a producer wrapping us in our ear.
Yeah, we have more than two and a half minutes.
I know.
What's that?
Yeah, so we could go as long as we wanted, but we'll try not to, you know, drone on and on about anything, of course.
We'll try. A keyword there is try.
We do like weather, though, so we tend to talk a lot about it. Well, today we want to talk a little bit about forecasting, something that we do on a day-to-day basis, and share something that we are really proud of as a weather team. So just recently, WeatherRate, which is this independent company that basically takes forecast products from all the different TV stations in the area and weighs them on different variables, essentially has told us that we are certified most accurate. And we were very excited about this because that is something that we strive for every day. And this area is tough to forecast for,
as we know.
But just to kind of break it down a little bit, you know, they look at all these different factors like high and low temperature, sky cover, precipitation, and one of the hardest ones, timing of the precipitation. And that's what matters to people, really. So we had to get a work on that. Strong wind, dense fog, severe thunderstorms, snow, ice, you name it, even though there hasn't been a whole lot of snow and ice this winter so far.
Yeah, a lot of disappointed winter fans.
I know.
You know, here recently, we're recording this in late January, and we've had our first like major cold snap, and people are like, okay, well, when's it going to snow? And I'm like, well, it's not going to, you know, so far,
sometimes you look at those climate outlooks that go up to 3 months out sometimes, which is just a it's just a projection. It's just an outlook, so it's not like gospel or anything. But sometimes you look for signs if you're looking for better than average chance of cold temperature and above average precipitation, then that might point to a little bit of hope for snow lovers, but we haven't had that yet this year. But that doesn't guarantee anything.
Right.
So still got a lot of winter left.
Yeah, it's interesting because, you know, January is typically when we get the most snow. I was doing some digging around, and we typically get, I can't remember if it was 2 or 3 inches on average in the upstate. You know, that's just an average, though. We can get any amount. But in February, our average is 1 inch. So it goes down once you get into February. But I tell you, since I've been here, I can recall some pretty big February snow, so you just never know. But kind of drawing it quickly back to WeatherRate, you know, it's just it's an exciting thing. It was a year-long project that this independent research company does, and they do it all over the United States.
They do.
So you may have been, I remember going to Tulsa and seeing a WeatherRate certified station, and I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. I wonder what that means. But now we really know what it means because we actually got the title. So
yeah, and you know, we kind of learned throughout this process too, you know, what they use to grade our forecast, you know, and it was interesting to see the system and, you know, just, I guess, like you mentioned, paying attention, you know, not that we don't already, but like, you know, sometimes we have specific windows like, well, is it going to rain between 10 and 7 a.m.?
Right.
And we just had to, you know, just really focus in, not that we don't already, but again, I think that's just, you know, important to, you know, have that reward for accuracy.
Right.
Absolutely. So. And there's a lot of different ways to grade a forecast, too. I mean, we did, like, forecasting challenges in college.
Yes.
I mean, there are so many ways to do it just because it's such a, you know, fluid process. And, yeah, it's just nice that we got some validation from that third-party vendor.
Absolutely. Well, just another reason that we hope you trust us with your forecast. And we're going to talk a little bit about what we look at every day with the forecast. You know, I'll go to these school talks, and, you know, the kids, all they want to hear about the tornadoes, hurricanes.
Snow.
The big stuff. Snow, of course, especially this time of year. But really, on a day-to-day basis, our main job is to look at lots of information, figure out, you know, timing of rain, high temperature, low temperature, all of this stuff, and then put together something that the public can consume, understand, without being too technical. And that is a really, that can sometimes be a challenge when you're looking at so much data. But, you know, the big thing with us, I think, is that not only do we look at a lot of information, we collaborate as a team. I can't count how many times we've gotten together, and the first thing we start talking about is, hey, so you went with the low of such and such, you know, how do you feel like we verified, and what's, you know,
yeah, we check that every day. We check that because, I mean, it gives you a baseline to start your next forecast. If you don't have the most recent current data or how, you know, the models did on the last forecast, then you have no baseline to forecast for the future. So that's why it's really important to discuss that kind of thing when you first collaborate.
Yeah.
And then we have that ever-important gut and experience, which I guess we'll get more into in a second.
Yeah, absolutely. But I tell you what, with the one of the biggest ones that I think we text the most about is when we have snow in the forecast. Every model run, we kind of discuss, you know, what's it going to mean, and are we going to end up upping our snow totals? So this can be a really tough place to forecast. We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to dive into a little bit more specifics, especially if you've got a little weather nerd in you. You're going to enjoy the next segment. So we'll talk about some of the things we look at to bring you the most accurate forecast.
Fox Carolina Weather. Weather Rate's certified most accurate local forecast.
Welcome back to the podcast. Kendra, Ben, and Isaac here talking a little bit about how we do the forecast. What you see every day during the morning show or during the weekends, 4 and 5 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, all our different shows, you see what kind of a consolidated version of what we've been looking at throughout the day. This, it's hard to actually see this. We don't even, can't get close up. This is our forecast sheet. We've got the days of the week. It basically looks like a 7-day forecast. We make little notes about what the models are saying on it. But you know, start with you, Isaac.
Sure.
When you know, when you get in the morning, talk to us a little bit about what you your forecast flow is like. And I know it's different for active versus non-active days, but like a, just a normal old day.
Well, first off, I like to just kind of dive right into the, I maybe do things a little backwards. Mm-hmm. I like to dive straight into the models and see what, you know, they're talking, showing, I should say. And then, you know, 5 days in a row, I get to, you know, say, okay, well, in my mind, this model did pretty well the day before. So anyway, I do a set look at the models, but then I look lastly at current conditions, because obviously we have to know what's going on at 4 o'clock in the morning when I'm in here forecasting. And basically I use what's happening, and then kind of, I have a photographic memory. And so I basically then just kind of review every model that I just looked at. And I'm like, well, did it handle this rain that's coming in? Does it know that there's clouds there? And sometimes I'll go back and double check. But basically the idea is when we look at computer models and see how they're doing, that we need to see if how they're initializing. Basically, did they capture what's happening accurately? And a lot of times,
If you forget to do that, then you can really be off the boat.
You really can, because you know, you sometimes, you know, we show future casts, and you know, we don't show future casts unless we think it's a pretty good depiction. If we don't think future cast is doing anything close to what we think will actually happen, we're not going to show it, because why would we get up there and say, hey, we think this rain's going to be 6 to 12 hours faster. So that's kind of my workflow, is that, you know, look at currents, then look at the models, make sure they're initializing well, and then go from there. And you know, when you showed that forecast, we didn't just pull a 70 or a 40 out of thin air. Like, a lot of thought and effort went into it.
Absolutely. And I know that your process is similar in that, you know, I'll be coming in and we'll be talking about the forecast, and I feel like often you look at those numerical models, charts, first to get a good big picture.
I do, yeah. It's kind of like Isaac. Like, the correct order to do things is to start with current conditions. That way you have that baseline. Some days, though, like especially in the winter time when you're watching out really long range for if we're going to have any indication of a winter weather event or anything like that, that's one of the biggest things we're on the edge of our seats about during the winter season. Yeah, usually sometimes we will just take a glance. That's probably the best way to put it. Just like a big picture type thing. But you're not really forecasting. Like, you're not going to fill in like, oh, we're definitely going to have rain this day before you have any other information besides that model run.
Just so you don't get caught off guard if there's something
that's
looming.
That's a great point. I don't fill out the sheet until I've looked at every single thing.
But the same goes with temperatures, though. Like, if we have a really quiet stretch of weather, dry stretch of weather, so you don't really have to look at initializing as much, just because it's clear outside, models don't indicate any cloud cover, so that's pretty cool. But then you have to look at, you know, the temperature and dew point side of things, just because you have to look at what our high and low was today, what the models predicted yesterday, how did each one do, and then you use that moving forward to determine what temperatures will be. So temperature, so if you're looking at those, you know, maps with precipitation predictions on them, then it's temperatures you look at. So it's one or the other, or both, depending on the day of forecasting to see how you
go. He brings up a great point. Like, sometimes they'll ask me, well, how do you know if it's going to be, you know, hot or cold? Well, is it cloudy? Has it been dry? I mean, there are so many factors to just to influence one thing. And, you know, trying to understand basically one big three-dimensional fluid is a lot.
And that's why there's no way to be 100% accurate in weather. We just do our absolute best.
That's why
and we
this,
learn
this weather
from
rate is most accurate.
Yes.
Because not it's not perfect.
100%.
There is no service whatsoever out there that has a 100% accurate forecast. Computer, human, doesn't matter. Like, there's no such thing as a 100% accurate weather
that's
forecast.
That's a good hot take right there.
That's a great hot take.
All right, so what are your tricks to the trade?
Well, yeah, I basically do something very similar. I was going to throw out some of the terms that many of you may know or may not know, but you know, we look at the exciting part of the forecast to me is looking at those model charts, you know, looking at numerical models out. You can, I mean, it's all magic, really is. To me, after about 6 or 7 days, you just look out past there on the GFS and see what kind of crazy weather system it's coming up with.
Right.
But it's good to look out far just so you can kind of follow the trends and see what's happening. That's the exciting part. I think what some might consider the most boring part is just crunching all the numbers. Looking at things like model output statistics, MOSS, which is kind of climate-based but also uses model data. Then you can look at raw numbers for the models, what they put out. So like when you're dealing with a low temperature, for instance, an unseasonably cold night, a lot of times MOSS doesn't handle that as well as raw data would because it's trying to take into account what's normal for this time of year.
That's
so you have to do
part.
A lot of number comparisons, which I actually kind of enjoy numbers, but it's just not the most, you know.
Yeah,
it's not the most relaxing thing, you know, to do because you get stressed because, you know, there's certain thresholds, you know, where people say, okay, well, if it gets below 25, you know, I'm wrapping my pipes, you know, and, you know, some people may not live or die, but basically like, oh, well, Kendra said it's only going to be 27, so my pipes are good. And then what happens if it's 23 or 22, you know? It can happen like that, but very rarely, you know, are we that far off. You know what
right,
I mean?
Right, exactly. So, yeah.
It can happen. I mean, we have those annoyances with difficult things to forecast, very bustable forecasts, the wedge, things like that.
Nothing like a good cool air wedge to knock our forecast off, off the grid even. Yeah. You know, we also look at things that are shorter range, and we look at these long range models, but also things like the HRRR or HRRR,
whatever we all call it.
But there are things like that that we'll actually show during the news because they're so good at tracking convective lines and things like that.
And a point to that is, you know, when you ask me about my workflow, I have an advantage over you in terms of the day of forecast.
Yeah.
You know, but then you have an advantage on just like the jet, because when I'm forecasting tomorrow, my tomorrow is like
it's way
24
away.
To 36 hours.
Pretty
in
long time in the meteorology
whereas
world.
Whereas theirs is just 12 or less. So we both have advantages, I guess.
I think, and the only other thing I was going to mention on my list of just stuff we check with is our gut, and I think that is. It's got to be high up on the list because you can look at numbers all you want, but when you've lived in an area for a while, you've seen a similar weather situation, you know, unfold.
Yeah.
You just have to. And I think one of my best examples of that is we've had a few winter weather systems where models are just cranking out all this snow.
That's crazy.
And you've seen something like this where you know, you look at the SKU-T and it's almost isothermal at 32 for several layers, and you're sitting there, you're thinking, models are putting this out as snow, but chances are it's probably going to be a lot of sleet. And we get a lot here. And then TR will get all snow.
Yep.
But Greenville, Spartanburg will get sleet mixed with snow. And that cuts your totals down from 6 inches to a measly inch and a half, which people look at us like you're crazy when you forecast more. So that's why it can be so tough. But in those situations, sometimes you have to look at those big model outputs and, you know, file them through a few.
And recognize because, you know, you may see people share, you know, different models online and, you know, the model physics are great, obviously, but, you know, as you mentioned, they see a specific, like, equation, basically, and the atmosphere does not follow a perfect equation, and sometimes models just incorporate snow plus the sleet and think, okay, well, it's just all snow. Just like you mentioned, it'll print out some 12-inch number when you know it may be half that or less, and, you know, that's where the human experience, the gut, everything else kind of.
And that's why we put the range, because there are times when I'm pretty sure it'll end up being partial sleet, but you would hate for that degree, you know, to be down one more degree and then be all snow. And I never want, I would rather bust the other way. I would not want to tell people it's going to be 2 inches of snow when we get a foot. Mm-hmm. That's the, to me, that would be the worst kind of bust, because people wouldn't be ready for. So we try to walk that line of showing you what to expect, but giving you the options and knowing what could happen.
Absolutely. And it's really difficult with snow predictions, too. I mean, ranges are nice because Mother Nature doesn't operate on a uniform basis. Mm-hmm. Like, when we say Greenville has a good chance of getting 1 to 3 inches of snow, for instance, I mean, thing is, snow can fall at very different rates within like the city limits of one city.
Right.
So one person's house might have half an inch, another there might be 5 inches. Mm-hmm. So 1 to 3 is just the most likely for most residents in the area when you're forecasting for a big area like that.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, especially down here, sometimes someone in Simpsonville might see all rain during an event, and someone in Traveler's Rest.
Sure, we have a lot of angry people down there.
Not necessarily us, but because
it's
just the way the atmosphere and elevation is.
You know, yes.
And I know I'll confess, you know, sometimes I see one of these crazy model outputs, or whatever, and out of all of us, you have the most experience in this area, and I will immediately text Kendra of like, oh my God, did you see this? And she's like, yes.
Settle down.
Let's watch it for a couple of days, and if it's still there in 3 days, then I'll be all in.
I tell you what, you know, we have the capability of getting big snows. I was doing that research on, you know, some of the biggest ones, you know, we've ever seen. And the biggest one I've ever covered here in Greenville was just over 6 inches, I believe it was. But you know, like that superstorm of 93, which was so legendary.
Yes, yeah.
We got 9.8 here in Greenville.
Wow.
I mean, you know, we can get those kind of snows. It's just not very often. And might I mention, it was during a neutral year. That superstorm of 93 happened
so
in a neutral.
Not El Nino or
sorry, I should back it up. We've been doing research on, you know, people get so fired up about El Nino and bringing big snows, but in neutral years, you can get some really big ones. Mm-hmm. But I just thought that was kind of interesting. But obviously, lots of forecast challenges in our area. We're going to take a quick break. Last segment, we're going to talk about some of our favorite and least favorite things to forecast and some of the things that come along with being a forecaster in this area. Thanks for sticking with us.
Fox Carolina Weather. Weather Rate certified most accurate local forecast.
We are back with the podcast. Kendra and Isaac and Ben here talking about what we do to forecast and how hard this area can be for forecasting. You know, we actually talked a good bit about winter weather forecasting. I would imagine, and I'm going to ask Isaac first, your favorite thing to forecast, I would imagine, would be severe weather, right?
Well, I mean,
obviously.
Yeah.
You used to work in Mississippi. I mean, yeah.
I did. I went to school
from
in
Alabama.
Mississippi. I worked in Mississippi. And, you know, every region has its own, you know, ingredients. But there are certain things that if you have three or four things in place, I mean, you're going to get severe weather. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but each region, as I mentioned, is different. And we don't have to have as much here as a place like maybe Mississippi to get, you know, major severe weather. We had issues earlier in this month.
January 11th.
You know, I thought, you know, things were set up to support maybe a spin-up tornado or two, but we ended up getting 5. Now, thankfully, they were all EF0s, but that's still significant. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, but certainly severe weather is my favorite. There are certain parameters that I almost swear by that they're not a slam dunk because they're still computer-based, but, you know, I know if a specific thing is showing something, there's going to be some problems.
What are some of your favorite parameters? You know, there's the supercell composite.
I like significant tornado parameter because basically it includes 3 of the 4 things you need, which are moisture, instability, and wind shear. The only thing it doesn't account for, I think, is just lift in general.
Right. And stuff.
So just check your cape and that. And yeah, that's a really easy to like sort of, what's the word I'm looking for? To speed up the process. Mm-hmm.
And then the other thing I like to look for in terms of tornado potential is what's called the SREF, Short Range Ensemble Forecast. And it's based off of SPC. It's called the SPC SREF. And I think I've shared this with you. I just like to call it for lack of a better term, the black box parameter.
Yes.
I mean, it's just like a probability of a tornado, basically. And I like to look at least there's like a 15% contour on there. Mm-hmm. And this is available to the public, so Google SPC SREF. If you want to start following it, you see a 15% circle over South Carolina, we're probably going to have some severe weather.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
we'll all be here.
Yeah, but severe weather certainly is my very favorite thing. What about you?
Yeah, it really is a mix. I can't believe I would say winter weather is one of my favorites. I think that I wish that I could do it, but not have the ramifications. I wish I could just go you know, with
put
a complete,
just put a
forecast out and run away. Exactly. Because that it's a very scary thing to go with your gut sometimes in that situation.
For sure.
But no, I'd have to say I do really like severe weather forecasting, but if I was going to weigh it, I think that just based on what I've done more of, probably would be winter weather, but either way.
Can I ask a follow-up? Yeah. May I ask a follow-up? Sure. So, do you like snow total forecasting more, or determining the precipitation type?
Type. It's more type for me.
Okay.
And that's one thing that I feel like if I was, the best thing I do when it comes to looking at a SKU-T diagram, and again, it's hard to explain those if you haven't been in weather, but it basically shows you the entire atmosphere as a parcel of air is pushed up. But I probably am best at looking at those when it comes to precip type rather than other things. I remember in school in Doug Gillum's class, if you're watching, I don't know why he'd be watching, that'd be great if he was. I think he lives in Canada now, but he can get it. Yeah, he can get it. But anyway, he taught me a lot about winter weather forecasting. What about you? What's your favorite?
You know, I pretty much have covered tropics, winter weather, and severe weather almost complete equals. So,
Forgot about the tropics too.
That's right. Yeah.
We're in the dead of winter.
Yeah. Exactly. I mean, my last market, Mississippi, I feel like it's a year-round severe weather season almost.
100%.
I mean, happens a little more in some seasons than others, but my last market in Sioux City, Iowa, I forecast it was about half winter, half severe weather, essentially. Mm-hmm. I would say the precip type in the wintertime is probably the most interesting because that little chart that shows the temperature and dew point of a parcel, you can look short range and do a decent enough job to predict precip type, whereas snow totals, it's a little bit more assimilating all the models in your head and coming up with sort of a compromise between all of them.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit different of a process. Mm-hmm. They can get interesting. I mean, it's frustrating when the models don't agree, say, 2 days out, which that's the point when you start to narrow it down.
Right, that's when we're rolling out precipitation type maps.
Making those
snow
maps.
Totals.
And that's what everybody wants is that, how much snow will it be? And I think maybe that's one of the reasons I don't like that part as much because of the pressure on it.
It's quantifiable and, people can just go out in their backyard and measure it. So it's definitely the thing we get yelled at most by viewers. That and cutting in during tornado warnings. But it's just a very quantifiable thing. Mm-hmm. Whereas sleet, freezing rain, the average person doesn't know the difference between the two, but
For us, it's all the difference in the world.
It is. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So. It's just like one layer being above or below freezing of the atmosphere.
And how deep is the layer? How warm is it? Oh, good luck. Well, I'll stick to my severe weather. They can have their winter.
Yeah. Well, and now I go back and forth, and then I do enjoy hurricane forecasting, but the fact that it's almost like we have too much information sometimes with hurricanes because
think
about how long we tracked Florence. Was it Florence that came right off Africa? And we tracked that thing for so long and all the ups and downs. You almost wish that you could just wait until it got a little closer to even have data because it's so hard to prepare for something.
Right.
But you obviously want as much lead time as possible.
Exactly.
But that cone of uncertainty changes so much.
And it does.
So that might be one of my least favorite, but
that part about it is frustrating. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's sort of a new novelty. Oops, sorry for hitting the mic there. but it's sort of a novelty for me still, just because it's my first time living in a tropical environment.
That was one of your reasons for coming here.
It's true.
That.
Yeah, it definitely
and we
got
delivered.
Me. It did, and then some. But honest to goodness, though, some of our long-range models can go as far out as about 2.5 to 3 weeks. The long-range GFS model and. Yeah, with the internet, information overload can be a thing. Like, too much information weather-wise can actually be a bad thing. It's like, yes, we do have that information, but anything beyond 7, some do 10 days, it's just not reliable. That's a reason why the Hurricane Center doesn't put those cones of uncertainty out for more than that forecast period, because that's as good of information they have. Just watch out for those posts on social media, those rogue social media posts.
Look for the sources, exactly. Yeah. And also read the explanation of it, too, because some people will post day 8 European model and then explain it a little bit, and then maybe it makes more sense. But I think some people just see the 12 inches of snow.
Or a hurricane 2 weeks from now hitting the South Carolina coast. Like, oh, well.
Yeah.
You need to evacuate now.
Exactly.
No, you just need to have a plan. You should always have a plan in place.
Yeah. What would you say is one of your biggest forecasting frustrations for this particular area?
So when I first got here, cold air. So in Mississippi, I realized they don't have any terrain out there. So one of my first real, we call it downsloping forecast events here. Mm-hmm. Basically, we had a cold front pass through and I'm like, okay, colder air is coming in. But it has to go up and then down the mountain. So when it comes down the mountain, I know that it does warm, but it looked
you know, the models looked pretty cold. And when we have this exact same setup in Mississippi, obviously it's just
there's nothing
cold.
To block it. Just right. Right. Right in.
It's just come
same
right
with,
in.
Same with Midwest.
And mm-hmm. I want to say, thankfully, WeatherRate wasn't obtaining our forecast back then. But I want to say, I'm like, oh, it's not going to warm that much. I'm going to forecast, I forget what it was, let's say 50. Ended up warming off the mountains, obviously. It was like 62 that day. And mm-hmm. I'm like, oh. So, yeah, just follow it. I think one of the most challenging things is forecasting, like, how fast does the upstate temperature drop after a cold front? Because oh, it's going to get to the mountains in Asheville. We know it's getting cold there. Mm-hmm. But I swear that 50 miles, it takes forever sometimes for, A, the cold air to kind of cross it. And then how severe is it? And, you know, sometimes it basically cold air advection is out. Weighed by the warming coming down the mountain.
Oh, you can. It can be 42 in Asheville and 70 in Greenville. Sometimes.
Right.
I mean, it's just
Which
crazy.
Is, yeah. Again, 50 to 60 miles. Mm-hmm. That's it. So yeah, I think that's my most frustrating thing here because you know in school they teach you mountain meteorology, right? But you don't have any experience depending on where you go to school.
Sure.
Since I went in Mississippi, we have no mountains there, so I see what's happened in a textbook, and then you get here and it doesn't quite follow the textbook exactly,
right.
And so you have to just use not your gut, but your experience. And mm-hmm. then when you see a similar situation in the future, that's when you go back to both of those and be like, okay, maybe I should have forecasted 60 instead of 50.
I think all of our frustrations may come from having the mountains close by. Mine is a cold air wedge, and it's not all about the cold air wedge. It's about when it retreats.
Right, mm-hmm. or if.
If it retreats.
When or if.
And that can mean the difference with ice storms. We've had that situation where we've been waiting on the cold air to finally retreat east, and it was going slower than anticipated. It can just be sensible weather. You're thinking it's going to be a sunny day by the afternoon and get up to 60 degrees, but the low clouds hold, and you stay 45 all day.
Right.
So it's, you know, it's and about the strength of the wedge, the placement of a high pressure to the north has a lot to do with that. But even knowing all of these different parameters, every wedge is different. So to me, I feel like you go in and you just have to do your best, I guess. But it's just very tough. Trust that gut, I tell you. What about you?
I would say it's those pop-up thunderstorms in the summertime.
Oh, that's a good one, too.
The way the WeatherRate obtains our forecast is for a point forecast. So this is for GSP International mm-hmm. Forecast. Every person here, I mean that in Asheville, but they have to use one point. So
sure.
GSP is our point. And we all know what those thunderstorms in the summertime mean. Some summers a little more active than others. But, you know, usually just they start in the mountains and then a few will move into the upstate, and sometimes GSP gets, you know, the short straw that day and they get a thunderstorm, which that day we may have only forecast in our 7 day a 30% chance, just because that's about the odds of a thunderstorm happening in a mm-hmm. given area would be. So
yeah.
I stick by that forecast, but if they see that I've got like a partly cloudy sky and just a small chance of thunderstorms that day, sometimes it's difficult when it gets rain.
And then that one storm develops over GSP and we're, you know.
But, I mean, you assume that might only happen, say, like 20, 30% of the time. Mm-hmm. And the other 70, you know, you're technically right. So sometimes if you're forecasting, you know, the main forecast is partly cloudy, muggy, hot. Yeah. But then, you know, if you don't mention put a big emphasis on rain, then one of those few times where that pop-up thunderstorm makes it to your point in your mm-hmm. forecast. So sometimes, I mean, you can't win them all, but you try to win most of them.
Well, and people in the summertime, you know, I can't tell you how many people schedule pool parties, schedule things, and I say, Kendra, what's the rain chance? And I'm like, well, it's 20%, but that's not zero. And it could happen, if it happens over you, it turns into 100%. You know, it's
right.
So
mm-hmm.
you just never know where those storms will pop up. And so, yeah, I see that frustration. And it's tough because it's hard to give someone a meaningful forecast on certain summer days because you can't really give them an answer. At least when we have a line of rain or a line of storms coming in, we can time that out a bit better.
Yeah.
Maybe not down to the minute, but usually down to the couple hour time frame of entry and exit. So yeah, I feel you on that one.
Yeah, the squall lines are actually a nice thing to forecast because it's pretty easy. I mean, like, we've got a lot of short range models that initialize well most of the time, but mm-hmm. You have to take into consideration where the squall is, you know, when you're forecasting. But yeah, it's a lot easier to pinpoint timing in specific places with those lines of thunderstorms rather than those pop-up thunderstorms. So, and the thing is, the average person probably doesn't, you know, have that in their head. Like, to the average person, it's just, oh, it rained, it stormed today, like, I had to go inside today. And, you know, they don't discern a difference between that and line of thunderstorms, whether they be severe or not.
Absolutely. Well, hopefully today you kind of realize how seriously we do take accuracy. Yeah. We talk about it a lot, and we do our absolute best, and we're just really proud to now be a Weather Rate certified station. We have their seal of approval, so to speak. So you'll see that on some of our graphics and some of our promos, but we just kind of wanted to let you know what it meant, and we just want to keep working to bring you the best forecast that we can. So thanks for joining us for the podcast, and we will have much more of these coming up throughout the spring and summer season. And if you have an idea for a podcast, email us, weather@foxcarolina.com. We're always looking for some good topics. See you guys a little later.